Hi, today we're going to talk about diodes. Now, I'm going to try to do my best to not get into the weeds too much on this and just give a conceptual overview of what diodes are, why they're important, some important aspects of diodes, things like that. And so hopefully Taylor will smack me around if I start getting too into the weeds. And as it is, let's get right into it. So a diode, in its most basic, is basically a one-way valve for electricity. So much like if you have a tube of water that has a flapper on it and the water flows this way and it pushes the flapper open and can flow just fine that way, but then comes back and it closes the flapper and can't go back that way, diode does the same thing with electricity. It's pretty cool because in the way we model it and the way we think about it, ideally, if you have a voltage over it, a voltage that's positive on the anode and negative on the cathode, that will make it so current can just flow, no problems, no inhibitions whatsoever. Whereas, ideally, if you have a positive voltage on the cathode and a negative voltage on the anode, it will block all current immediately. And so in an ideal model, it'll look basically like this. Your IV curve will show nothing in the negative side and then an immediate infinite current as soon as you hit anything above 0 volts as a positive voltage. Now, the reality is it doesn't quite work like that. The reality is when you do have a reverse voltage, there's a little bit of leakage current, kind of thinking of that flapper, probably have some water leaking out through the sides, that's true. Also, and we'll get into this a little bit more later, if you have enough force pushing backwards, that flapper will break and you'll actually get a huge rush of current in the negative direction. But even besides that, as we're going from that negative voltage and we hit 0 volts and then start going above 0 volts, there's actually a little bit of pressure that needs to be overcome before it can conduct in the forward direction. So just as if that flapper in our model needs a little bit of pressure to push it up and out of the way, it's the same thing with a diode. Now that forward pressure, that forward voltage as it's called, V sub F, it depends on what diode you're working with. So the normal typical diode is 0.7 volts. But you can get down to about 0.3 volts with a schottky diode, and you can get quite a bit higher than 1 to 4 to whatever volts if you're looking at a power diode or an LED, which is a subset of diodes. So in reality, you have this kind of weird curve that it's slight negative current when you have a negative voltage, and then at 0 volts, it starts to slightly conduct in the forward direction. And then once you hit that V sub F, you have a not immediately infinite, but highly spiking current in the forward direction. And that is a bit complicated. It's hard to work with. So usually when we're dealing with diodes, we'll deal with it in one of two models. And that is either the assumption that there's absolutely no current, anything below 0 forward volts, and infinite current, anything above 0 volts. So to create a compromise between the ideal model, which is pretty unrealistic, and the actual way that a diode works, which is pretty complicated, we also work with a constant voltage diode, which is a compromise of sorts in that you still assume very simplistically that there is absolutely no current from any negative voltage up to the forward voltage, and then at that forward voltage, it immediately spikes to infinity. So in reality, the only thing we're doing with the ideal model is shifting the point in which the current goes from 0 to infinity to the more realistic forward voltage that you're actually expecting. So one of the challenges about dealing with diodes like this is that it's non-linear. So if you're watching this video, most likely you are familiar with at least the basic circuits. You've dealt with resistors, capacitors, and inductors. And DC or AC, whether or not you're taking impedance, reactance, that sort of thing into account, those can all be modeled linearly. And that is not something you can do with the diode. So instead of just being able to say, hey, I have this diode in here and it's represented by this number, you actually have to look at your circuit and make some assumptions saying, I think that this diode is going to be forward biased. With the way all of the voltages are going, I think that voltage is going to be higher there than right there. And so let's assume that's forward biased. And then that means either it's a short or we're just going to act like there's a 0.7 volt drop across it. And then you have to solve everything. And then you have to go back and check and say, oh, actually that was a negative voltage across that, which means that that is reverse biased, which now I have to assume that is an open and I have to redo the entire circuit. So it gets a little bit more complicated in that, unlike other things, you have to make an assumption, solve everything, check your assumption, and if it's not right, change your assumptions and redo it. And you can do it multiple multiple times, and it can be a little bit frustrating, but once you get better with circuits and you get more comfortable with it, it's going to become easier. But that is one of the biggest challenges of working with diodes, is even though conceptually they're pretty simple and you don't have some of the complications that you do with impedance and reactance, you still have that non-linearity that you have to deal with. So that makes it pretty fun. So let's go into a couple of things. I have a couple different diodes here to one show how they look almost the exact same, even though they're completely different. And then I also want to go over a couple of the most important names, attributes, that's the word I was looking for. Most important attributes of a diode. So when you're looking at a data sheet or you're trying to figure out if something's gonna work, make sure it actually does work for your circuit. So first off, I just wanna show right here, I have a regular power diode and I have, I think, and this is part of the challenge here, one of these is a schottky diode. I think these are schottky diodes, these are zener diodes, and then these are lower power or signal diodes. But if you look at them, they all look basically the same. They're just slightly different sizes. So it's incredibly important to note that there is writing on here, and we'll get some close-up shots of it. And that is how you're going to know what exactly you're working with, because otherwise, if I don't put these back in the right bags, I'm gonna be incredibly confused later. Right here, I've got my general purpose diodes, and these are something I'd use in a typical wave rectifier that's low power, something that I'd only have a couple of milliamps, or probably could go up to an amp on these, I'd have to look up the data sheet, whereas this one I think is a couple of amps. So that's a general purpose versus a power diode. Now as you look at these look almost the exact same, but they do completely different things. This is a schottky diode, and these are zener diodes. And we've done some tutorials on zener diodes, and they're pretty interesting, so I'd go and check those out, but we haven't done anything on schottky diodes. But the biggest thing I want to point out here is, even though there are similarities in the way that they're built, and there's a lot of physical similarities in looking at it, you need to read the fine print on the side to know exactly what they are. And please be careful, because they act very differently. And if you put in a schottky diode when you mean to put in a zener diode, things are going to get really ugly. So double check all that stuff. If you want to learn more information about that, we're not covering that in this video, so go look somewhere else. But the biggest thing to note between all of these is all diodes are basically two-port devices. You have one side where it goes in, one side where it goes out. And also on all of these, despite being different sizes, all of them have a white band on one side, and that denotes the cathode. So as we talked about that earlier, if this is forward biased, you will have a higher voltage on this side and a lower voltage on this side. Whereas if you go the other way, you'll have higher voltage on this side and a lower voltage on this side. So current can only flow in that direction. Okay, so let's go over a couple of the terms that you're gonna need to know working with these diodes. And the first one is the forward voltage. And that is basically knowing at what point, when you forward bias that diode, it starts to conduct. And that's really important. Now, the interesting thing is you also need to know the reverse voltage, V sub R. And you'd think, well, what does that mean? Because it shouldn't be conducting at all in the back in the other direction. But in reality, it does. And that, as I was talking about earlier, that's when the breakdown happens. That's when you do so much pressure in the opposite direction that you break down and you start conducting in the reverse direction. So forward voltage, you want that to be as small as possible, typically. And reverse voltage, you want that to be as big as possible, typically, unless you're working with zener diodes. Again, go check out our tutorials on zener diodes if you want to know what I'm talking about with that. And then really the only two big things that you really should know is related to those, and that's the forward current, is knowing how much current you can put through it without it burning out. Like I mentioned earlier, this one is big and it's a power diode, and the point is that it can take several amps instead of just a couple hundred milliamps or just one amp. Whereas if you get small signal diodes, they can only handle a couple of milliamps before you burn it out. So again, ideally, in a perfect world, a diode can conduct as much current as you possibly want, but in reality, of course, that is not the case. And just as we assume that there's absolutely no current when you are reverse biased, there is, and so we need to know the reverse leakage current or the reverse current, and that's basically just what happens when you have a reverse bias on a diode, how much of it is leaking through. And all of these things, forward voltage, forward current, reverse current, those are trade-offs. If you want a better thing of one, if you want a better forward voltage, that usually means that you don't have as good of a forward current and things like that. So there's no such thing as the perfect diode. It's all about trade-offs and what you need for your application. Okay, I think I went way too in-depth on that, and I'm blaming Taylor on this. He was supposed to be the one to smack me down if I went off rambling, and he didn't. So this is all your fault, Taylor. If you have any questions, we've done a lot of tutorials on PN junctions and semiconductor devices, which explains how these things work. So go check those out. If those questions aren't answered by the tutorials we already have, jump onto CircuitBread.com, leave a comment on the tutorial, leave it in YouTube or whatever, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Hope you enjoyed this video. Hope it was interesting and informative. If you liked it, give the video a like, subscribe to our channel, all that good jazz, and we will see you in the next one.